That's who's there. Carried me back to old Virginia.
1619 was a tremendously innovative year for Virginia. But how would those new changes impact the growing colony? If they were negative, would the venture survive? If they were positive, would that spark interest in Virginia from other sources, say the crown? What about some of the former enemies such as Spain or the Powhatan tribes? How would they respond to the relatively rapid emigration increase? Virginia was certainly in a transition period, and with those transitions came new challenges. The biggest such issues, however, first plagued the colony from afar.
Taking over this town, they should worry. But these problems aside, I think I taught you well. That we won't run, and we won't run, and we won't run. That we won't run, and we won't run, and we won't run.
Political infighting amongst the company's leaders tore the venture apart. Edwin Sandys was not a welcome member of the governing council, but Sandys had better parliamentarian connections and soon maneuvered his way around and through the older company administrators. He even had Thomas Smythe, one of the earliest and most prominent founding members of the company, stunningly replaced during a company election. Smythe had occupied his company seat, that of treasurer, or basically the governor, for 12 years by April 1619. He voluntarily chose to quit the post, but he and his close allies planned to elect Smythe's replacement from among themselves. Alderman Robert Johnson, the champion of Smythe and his allies, however, did not receive anywhere near the 59 votes of the winner and newly elected company treasurer, Edwin Sandys himself. That victory was followed up by Nicholas Ferrars being elected Sandys' deputy. As the night of April 28, 1619 unfolded, it became abundantly clear that Smythe and his mercantilistic mindset were being rejected. But the change in company leadership was too late. The company was still destined for failure, as poor decisions started to catch up to reality. An audit revealed just how bad the finances were, and though Sandys had some success with his economic and political reforms, the damage was already done. The company was in debt around £9,000, double the amount owed to the venture by subscribers. Sandys quickly moved to raise money in various ways, most notably by using the lotteries. But that work was a total disaster. Corruption and embezzlement charges followed Sandys' attempts, and soon brought him, as well as the company, to her knees. By 1621, when newly arriving settlers were making money hand over fist, the Virginia Company was bankrupt. Adding to the company's financial woes was Robert Rich the Younger's, the new Earl of Warwick, jumping into the fray. Rich, as his father before him, wanted to benefit himself through war with Spain. To that end, he attempted to act like former leaders from Queen Elizabeth's time. That meant that he'd play the pirate and attack Spanish shipping interests, which is how the first Africans arrived in Virginia, as we've already discussed. His actions, however, threatened to reignite war with Spain, something neither the company nor country desired in 1619. Rich's piratical actions fractured any relationship he might have had with Thomas Smythe, who suffered much from Rich's hatred. Rich certainly influenced Smythe's replacement as treasurer, but he soon ran afoul of Sandys for much the same piratical reasons, specifically the treasurer's encounter with the San Juan Bautista. Sandys understood that the treasurer's stealing Spanish property was a serious enough issue that could allow King James to abolish the company altogether. That being the case, Sandys moved rapidly to squash the issue by being the bearer of bad news to the crown personally. If it had been otherwise, then Sandys would not have been in control of the situation as he had desired. After reporting the altercations to King James, Sandys went to great lengths to distance himself and Virginia from Rich and his ship's actions. The plan worked, in that it lessened tensions with the crown. It failed, however, in that it opened a new feud with Robert Rich the Younger. Rich gathered his allies and led a charge to remove Sandys from the treasurership. Sandys readied himself to join the fight, but he couldn't have known that the company's troubles had reached the king's attention. Thus, the recently repaired relationship with King James was now under attack once again. James sent an ambassador to the company's 1620 elections, where the company leaders were told that the next treasurer could be chosen only from the king's handpicked list of four names. Sandys's name was not on the list. But he still attempted to act as if nothing had happened. In fact, he and his allies postponed the election until the next quarter in order to find out how to handle the new circumstances surrounding their impending fall. Sandys moved through his available channels, but in the end, James made his opinion very clear by saying, "Choose the devil if you will, but not Edwin Sandys." Yet Sandys had one other trick up his sleeve, in that he encouraged Henry Wriothesley, the Earl of Southampton, one of his own allies, to stand for the post. Southampton won, and stunningly, the Sandys faction remained in power, but only just. This is where Virginia re-enters the narrative. Because of the increasingly contentious standoff that now involved the crown, Sandys began making bolder proclamations. He even went so far as to term the colony as its own commonwealth and state. Statements like these were dangerous to say the least, and they attracted negative attention from powerful people. Regardless, Sandys then went about reshaping colonial leadership. He had Yardley removed and Sir Francis Wyatt installed as the new governor in Virginia. Then Sandys began preparing for a new charter, in which the newly established House of Burgesses was to be highlighted, showing that the colony was already a self-sufficient commonwealth of her own. All of this unraveling tension was set against the backdrop of an already increasingly belligerent European scene that had erupted into what would become known as the Thirty Years' War, starting in 1618. The basket of issues reached a boiling point when James called Parliament together in order to discuss a raise in taxes that he viewed necessary. Amid that discussion, Virginia and her rapidly expanding economy received attention. Some argued that the king could just take money from the colony, while others countered by saying that such action would be a violation of English law. James didn't have time for such discussions. He soon lost patience with the proceedings and zeroed in on a group of 12 members of Parliament that he believed were leading a conspiracy to lead the House of Commons against the Crown's wishes. Those men happened to be allied to Sandys, and they often met at Southampton's house to plot a conspiracy, as reported by King James' spy network. James' blood boiled. He reportedly shot out that the Virginia Company was a seminary for seditious Parliament during a meeting with the Spanish ambassador. He then issued an ultimatum to the company after learning about the apparently conspiratorial meetings. The Parliament was to be dissolved in a week's time, unless it complied with his monetary demands. Sandys loosened his tongue and let flow a fiery invective that blasted the Crown's failure to support the Huguenots, its economic ineptitude, and corrupt governmental cronyism, all of which led to England's contemporary failures, all of which were King James's fault. These words sealed his immediate fate, and Sandys was arrested on June 16, 1621, and kept prisoner until July 18. The Virginia Company was teetering on the brink. But somehow, it survived. Nevertheless, her days were drawing to a close. The fact that Sandys was thrown into prison certainly illustrates that the company was in serious trouble. Sandys the parliamentarian had many enemies, and those enemies spread far and wide. Some of them were in the king's privy council, the very same council that informed the king of Sandys' sedition. But James and his privy council didn't stop with Sandys' jailing, however. They wanted to make an example of just how seditious activity would be handled. In order to do that, they planned to end the Virginia Company. Yet at the same time, Sandys and his men were planning a newly revised charter that they were going to offer King James in 1622. Meanwhile, James planned to annul the entire business. But he and his advisors reasoned that such stark action would certainly create more enemies than they could destroy. After Sandus was released from prison, he kept an extremely low profile for many months. So low, in fact, that many of his colleagues thought something more sinister had taken place. Even his sending a note to the newly reconvened November 1621 Parliament didn't stop rumors from spreading. His absence had apparently caused such an uproar that the Secretary of State, George Calvert, had to order the members to move on to the business at hand. Regardless of Calvert's order, the situation in Parliament remained very tense, as many of the MPs were afraid to say anything that might offend the Crown. Finally, Parliament chose three MPs to see Sandus in person. He recounted his 5-week prison time in which he was grilled by the King's men. Was he leading a rebellion? Was he stirring up Parliament against James? Was it his fault that James couldn't get his requested funds to fight in the war? Who did he speak with? What did they speak about? Sandus told about his home being searched, in which incriminating documents were obtained. Those documents apparently challenged the King's divine right, a very serious issue during this European era. Further, correspondence between the supposed Brownist faction in the Netherlands was discovered, in which Sandus discussed plans to help the Mayflower and her venturers to reach Virginia. All of this looked very bad on Sandus, but the King's interrogators couldn't pin Sandus down on anything serious enough to punish him more severely. They let him go, but told Sandus to stay at his home in Kent. Because of actions just like this, James' reputation was suffering during this time, and it's no coincidence that many of the slanderous stories, some true, some false, regarding a wide variety of issues were created during this period. James reasoned that releasing many long-standing political prisoners would help his reputation. Sandus was one of those who ultimately benefited from this opinion in that he was released. But he was not the same man after he was freed, and the parliamentary faction quickly realized that. Even so, Sandus tried to wisely play the situation to his benefit. He waited until he was needed in Parliament once again, and that time came in May 1622 at the Quarter Court. Sandus planned to see just how much public opinion had turned against James during this time. James, for his part, planned to use the situation in such a way that he'd ultimately annul the Virginia Company once and for all. But Sandus's plans were hamstrung by the company's lack of profits. Further, James banned Sandus's most profitable short-term cash cow, the lotteries. The king claimed that the lotteries were racked by fraud and abuse, and had to be shut down. Sandus said about having them reinstated, but his jail time ended that plan. The next option available would prove to be the company's undoing. The company's tobacco monopoly granted by James himself ended in 1619. Now Virginia's major import could be taxed severely based upon the king's fancy, and he had no fancy for the vile weed. So the tobacco question had her major enemy in the king. But the already widening chasm separating Sandus and Smythe's company factions became even greater because of the tobacco problem. Another wrinkle was added when Ferdinando Gorgas was given a new patent for his New England project in 1620, in which the new boundaries overlapped lands originally given to the Virginia Company. The company's leaders feared that the new patent was the king's intent to undermine Virginia in an overt manner, and they weren't far off. Sandus had wanted to address all of these issues at the May 1622 Quarter Court, and he had wanted to answer them, oddly for Sandus, who was such an opponent of the tobacco monopoly, by creating a tobacco monopoly. The proceedings got underway when, not soon after, a message was sent by Secretary of State George Calvert through a Mr. Hammersley. Hammersley read that the king didn't want to, quote, infringe upon the liberty of their free choice, but he wanted them to consider 5 of his hand-picked nomination for the company treasurer. The company chose 2 nominations from the king's list, But they, as well as others, were defeated by the incumbent Earl of Southampton and Nicholas Farrar, his deputy. When the news of Southampton and Farrar's re-election reached King James, the king was furious. James wanted a merchant to be in charge of the flagging company, supposedly to carry on Thomas Smythe's good example, an example of many commodities being produced, not just tobacco. Matters deteriorated rather quickly after that. Captain John Martin asked the king for 80 miles of forest that would have included many plantations, as well as Jamestown itself, essentially making the colony the king's land outright. The company saw the trap and refused, while criticizing Martin heavily for playing his part in the matter. Finally, tobacco's negative influence began undoing the company in June 1622. It was at this time that King James' royal treasurer proposed a novel idea. Why not align the related Virginia and Bermuda companies in an effort to petition for the desired tobacco monopoly? It was genius. The idea came, so it seemed, from a favorable King James. Therefore, Sandys had no choice but to back down from his stance against monopolies. Further, he had to work closely with Thomas Smythe once again, because though Smythe was no longer in charge of the Virginia Company, he was still in control of Bermuda. Talks between the two bitter rivals began to work out the details surrounding a potential monopoly. But just as headway was being made, something much more serious came to light. The Sea Venture, a ship built in honor of her shipwrecked namesake, arrived with horrific stories from Virginia. Stories of an Indian attack. There was no way to contain the news, and that news ended all hope of the Virginia Company's future. Thank you for your continued support. It's greatly appreciated. Please continue spreading the word and help our colony to keep growing. Follow us on your favorite podcast provider, like us on Facebook, and visit our website. Sharing episodes and other work across the internet is the best way to expand the community. Another way to greatly aid the podcast is by providing feedback on iTunes. If you have yet to do so, please take a few minutes and leave us a comment. Doing so helps bring exposure in the iTunes network. If you would like to do more, please consider supporting the podcast on Patreon. Links can be found on the website, or one can visit the campaign at patreon.com/VAHISPod to see the choices and rewards being offered for your support. Please tune in next time as I recount the fateful March 1622 day that rocked the Virginia Company and ultimately ended her existence not too long thereafter. Do do bad, despedido do zen, bazen.